want to know your heart. Oh, I want to know your will. Take my heart and mold it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my to know your heart. Oh Lord, I want to know your will. Take me higher, draw me nearer, fill me with your power. Oh Lord, make me your. So my desire is just to do your will. Oh Lord, oh Lord, set my heart on fire for you, for you,
for you.
To know your heart, oh, I want to know your will. Take my heart and mold it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my to know your heart. Oh Lord, I want to know your will. Oh Lord, I want to talk like you. I want to walk like you. I want to act like you. I want to be like you. I want to know.
Rise up as we pray together. Our great God in heaven, we thank you for our Bible study. We bless your name because you watched over us and you've given us the interest and the love and the thirst to study your word. We're praying that tonight as we study your word, you open the pages of the scriptures to everyone in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, we'll be doers of the word and not hearers only. Every instruction you give us, every example you give us, and everything you tell us to do, Lord, in your grace, by your power, through your spirit, we're going to do everything in Jesus' name. And we pray that our service for you will bear fruit. That, Lord, during this coming retreat, you'll bless all those who are going to come in a wonderful way in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40. I'm reading verses 3, 4, and 5. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3, 4, and 5. The voice of him that cries in the wilderness, repair ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. As you know, we're preparing for our Easter retreat, and I believe that as people come, and as you come, because I know you are coming. Where are you? You are coming in Jesus' name. We'll be there, and great will be our celebration in Jesus' name. But we need to prepare. That's why we're looking at this special study. It says in that verse 3, prepare ye the way of the Lord. What does that mean? That is, the Lord wants to come. And the way he wants to take to come, we prepare that way. That's what he said, that we prepare the way of the Lord. And then he goes on to say, make straight in the desert a highway, not just for us, for our God. So that there will be no hindrance at all for the outpouring of the Spirit of God, of the power of God, of the blessings he wants to give us. Then he tells us in verse 4, every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. He's telling us that when he comes, because he tells us, prepare the way in verse 3, prepare the highway for God in verse 4. And when that is prepared, then he says, every mountain will be removed, every valley will be filled, every hill will be removed, every difficulty and challenge be taken away by the glory of the Lord in Jesus' name. And then it says in verse 5, it says, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. That means that in your life, whatever will bring glory to God will be revealed in Jesus' name. those challenges and those problems and those difficulties and those heartaches and those problems, when the glory of God comes, then everything is going to be taken away in Jesus' name. Do you remember that man that was sick, and then the disciples asked, how is this man born blind? Is it because of his sin or his parents' sin? And Jesus said, no. Jesus said, for the glory of God, that the glory of God may be revealed in the healing of that man, the deliverance of that man. And when God blesses you and saves you and sanctifies you and purges and purifies you, and when God brings strength, inner strength to your life, and when God takes away all sicknesses and all dominions of Satan, when all that is taken away, that's the glory of God, and that glory of God is coming in Jesus' name. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. You'll see it in Jesus' name. Then it says, and the mouth of the Lord, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. I want to turn to the New Testament to show you the application of that which we have just read now. It's in Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, I'm reading there from verse 1. It says in verse 1, Matthew chapter 3, in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. That tells us then the application of the word which we read in Isaiah. It says, number one, is fulfilled in John the Baptist, and it's going to be fulfilled in your life. It says, when John came and he began to say, repent ye, for the kingdom of God is at hand, it was simply fulfilling what had been said by Isaiah, that the way of the Lord will be fulfilled, will be made straight, which means then repentance makes a way for the Lord to come into your life. That means that when you turn around and all those abominations and defilements and sinful things, iniquity, when you repent away from that, it says you are preparing the way of the Lord, and then you are making straight his pathway, and then there's a highway that comes, the highway of holiness, when your life is purified, when your life is purged, and when all those dirty things are taken away, and now the Lord says, I can walk in your life, because there's a straight way now, highway now into your life, and the glory of God will be easily manifested because repentance has taken place. It says it was fulfilled in John, because it says the voice that's crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord and make his path straight. Let's look at Luke chapter 1. See, looking at the fulfillment, what is said in Isaiah chapter 14. Luke chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 76. Luke chapter 1, verse 76, and thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way. You see that? He was to come before the Lord Jesus Christ to prepare the way for the Lord Jesus Christ. For Jesus Christ, the Savior, to come in. Jesus Christ, the healer, the redeemer, and the deliverer, to come in. John went before him and he prepared the way. Actually, he prepared the hearts of the people. In preparing the hearts of the people to receive the word of God, to receive the Savior, to receive the sanctifier, to receive the healer, the redeemer, the deliverer, he was preparing the way of the Lord. That's what it means when he says, prepare the way. I hope you are not thinking that prepare the way means I take a cutlass and then I go to weed, I go to make the path. That's not it. We're talking about something spiritual. When you call people and you bring them to the knowledge of the Lord, and their hearts are ready, their hearts are open to now receive the Lord, you're preparing the way. Look at verse 77. To give the knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins. That's preparing the way as we come to this retreat. And then we'll prepare the way, and people open their hearts for the remission of sin, for the forgiveness of their sin, and for the salvation of the Lord to come into them. That's preparing the way. It goes on to say in verse 78, it says, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high has visited us. That is, when all darkness is taken away, darkness will go. All the paths of darkness will be broken, and then the light of the Lord. and the knowledge, the light, the strength, the power, the grace, the mercy of God comes in our lives. That's preparing the way. That's what the Lord is calling us for. He's saying that this wonderful retreat is coming and that everybody will receive. That's why preparation is necessary. Verse 79, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. That is where there has been strife and conflict, enmity and hatred, to guide us in the way of peace. Look at Luke chapter 1 verse 16. It's still talking about what John the Baptist will do. And that's an example for you, illustration for you, for me, as to what we're going to do as we're making preparation for the Lord to come in his fullness, to come in his power, to come in his overflowing spirit, so that the people can receive the abundance from the Lord. Luke chapter 1 verse 16, and many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God. That's preparing the way. That's preparing the way. It's not just, it's not only physical preparation, it's a spiritual preparation, that the minds of the people are turned to the Lord, the hearts of the people, they are turned to the Lord, turned away from their sin unto the Savior, turned away from darkness unto light, and turned from evil unto the goodness of God. That's what it means to prepare the way, preparing the way of the Lord. It says many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias, that's Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And that's what he wants us to do. We're going to prepare ourselves so that we'll be used of the Lord to prepare the people of God for the coming of the Lord, in Jesus' name. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel were told to gather together, the men and the women and the children, all to gather together so that they will celebrate the word of God, hear the word of God, understand the word of God, and apply the word of God to their lives. Let's look at some few verses of scripture that told them they must gather and they must listen to the word of God. And it's not a matter of, well, if I have time, if I don't have this commandment. And a commandment is supposed to be obeyed. And when we do not obey the commandment, that's a sin. That's disobeying the Lord. We're not going to disobey. I said we're not going to disobey. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 31. I'm reading there from verse 12. Deuteronomy chapter 31 verse 12. Gather the people together, men, women, and children. You see that? That's a commandment of God. This is not an opinion. This is not an idea. This is not a suggestion. It's not, you know, it doesn't even give room for discussion. It just says, this is what to do. And thank God for many, many years now, that is what we have been doing, because we're obedient children. And we're going to keep on obeying the Lord in Jesus' name. It says in that verse 12, gather the people together, men and women and children, and thy stranger that is within thy gates. And then it says that they may hear and they may learn. It's very clear, very clear. The purpose of the retreat is so that we'll hear the word of God, we'll learn the word of God. Then it says, and fear the Lord your God, and observe to do all the words of this law. The reason why we're gathering together, number one, is because we're commanded to do that. And the obedience to the commandment of the Lord, that's why we're gathering together during this holiday period, Easter period. And nobody has any excuse, because those days are free. That's the reason you are going to be there. And when you are there, as you come there, you listen to the word of God, great will be the manifestation of the power of the Lord in your life, in Jesus' name. We're going to look at it in three perspectives. Number one, personal preparation for the promised blessing. Personal preparation. And we're going to extend that to proper preparation. We're going to extend that to plural preparation, which means everybody preparing, you preparing, I myself preparing, and all our leaders preparing, and all our men, all our women, all our children, all our youths preparing. Plural preparation for the promised blessings. Number two is proclamation by the people desiring the promised blessings. Because we are people who desire the blessings of the Lord, we proclaim it, we publish it. and we publicize, we tell it everywhere, so that we'll not be selfish. Other people will come and share with us, and great will be the sharing of the blessings of the Lord in Jesus' name. Number three is preparation and prayer. Prayer and preparation. Prayerful preparation for the promised blessings. That we pray, we also participate. We make up our minds, we're going to be there, and we clear all hindrances and disturbances out of the way, so that we will be there. We're looking at number one. Number one is personal preparation for the promised blessing. We're looking at Job. Job chapter 11. In Job chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 13. Job chapter 11, verse 13. It says, if thou prepare thine heart, you see that the first thing to prepare is our heart. Because our heart must go along with everything we're doing. If the heart is not there, it's not going to matter at all to the Lord. If it's only with the head, with the mind, with the feet, if it's only physical, only something natural, our heart is not there, our interest is not there, the joy is not there, the excitement is not. Well, they say, let us go, I'm going. They say, there's retreat now, nobody will stay behind, I'm not going to stay behind. No, not that. Excitement and joy that this is something the Lord himself has commanded and appointed. And because this is what the Lord has appointed, I'm so glad I'm part of this. And then I prepare my heart. And it says, see thou prepare thine heart and stretch out thine hands toward him. If iniquity be in thine hand, put it far away, and let not wickedness dwell in thy tabernacle. That's preparation. The personal preparation we need to make, we check up our houses, we check up our hearts, we check up in our lives. If there's anything that is odious to the Lord, if there's anything that is kind of an abomination before the Lord, we get rid of all those things, because we're preparing for the coming of the Lord in a mighty way to visit us during the retreat. In fact, it says in verse 15, for then shalt thou lift up thine face without spot. Yea, thou shalt be steadfast, and shall not fear. Fear will go away from your life. Because thou shalt forget thy misery. Your sorrows forgotten. Sicknesses forgotten. Calamity forgotten. All the yokes forgotten. And all the problems you are going to forget in Jesus' name. If you believe, you'll see the glory of God. I believe. I believe. I believe. All my sorrows are gone. In Jesus' name. It says, you remember it as waters that pass away, and thine age shall be clearer than the noonday. I thought you'll say amen. That means you look younger, you'll feel younger, you'll act younger, everything within you will receive new life in Jesus' name. Thou shalt shine forth, thou shalt be as the morning, and thou shalt be secured because there is hope. Yea, thou shalt dig about thee, and thou shalt take thy rest in safety. Also, thou shalt lie down, and none shall make thee afraid. Yea, many shall make suit unto thee. Looks like all you've been looking for is coming during this retreat. Everything I've been planning to have, and when will I have this? When will I have that? The time has now come. And we're talking about preparation. All the preparation we're making, I've spoken to you about personal preparation there. Let's look at another kind of preparation in Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15, we're looking at verse 2. Exodus 15, verse 2. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, I will exalt him. You see the preparation there? I'll prepare him a habitation. That means then, as we're looking forward to the retreat, there's some people, they only think about publicity. That's great. That's wonderful. We're going to get to that. But preparing an habitation, where the people are going to stay, and where the Lord will visit the people, where the children will have their meeting, and then God will come in a mighty way and bless those children, where the youths are going to meet, we are preparing that habitation too, where God will be able to dwell with those young people and roll all their mountains away, and where the women and the pregnant women, the aged women, where they're going to stay, and there it will be an habitation for God, and God will move in a mighty way, where the men, where they're going to stay, and God will move in in a mighty way, where our choir will stay, our ushers will say, our security will say, all the people are going to do have essential service. What they're going to say, we prepare a place for them, and then where the preachers are going to stay, when all the people, when they're going to congregate together, that's what he's saying, we prepare an habitation for the Lord. And then the Lord is looking at the habitation we're preparing and says, children session, that's all right, youth is all right, and adult, that's all right, and where we're living, everything is all right, and the women are in a very good place separate from where the men are. That's preparation, and that's what the Lord is saying, that we make the appropriate preparation, and when we do that, great will be our blessings in the mighty name of Jesus. In First Chronicles 29, First Chronicles chapter 29, we're talking about preparation, preparing a house, an habitation, a tabernacle, the place of meeting that needs to be prepared to. In First Chronicles chapter 29, verse 2, it says, "And now I have prepared with all my might the house of my God." You see, there are people, your retreat is coming. How about the place, the house of my God, where the people are going to meet together, all the electronics and everything we need to prepare. It's not that that day comes and then we're running about. We're ready, we're prepared. And the house of the Lord is well prepared. And then it says, the gold for the things of gold. And then it says, the made of gold, and the silver for the things of silver, and the brass for the things of brass, and the iron for the things of iron, and the wood for the things of wood, and onyx stones. And then it says, stones to be set, and glistening stones, and of diverse colors, and all manner of precious stones and marble stones, and in abundance. Maybe this surprises you, but you understand what the electronics need is need different for what the, you know, people in the kitchen, what they need, and what the people in the kitchen is different for what the ushers need, and what the ushers need be different for what the choir needs. It's saying that all the areas of preparation, that the people be able to have proper accommodation and proper understanding, and then they settle down and enjoy and celebrate the retreat. And that's what the Lord is saying, we're going to make adequate preparation. It goes on to say, verse 3, "Moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have of my own proper good of gold, of silver, which I have given to the house of my God, over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house." It says, even 3,000 talents of gold. See this, one single man, although a king, preparing all this. I challenge all the other people to prepare. All those who are rich and all those that God has blessed with material things will bring everything at this time, and we get prepared for this coming retreat. Then it goes on to say, of the gold of Ophir and 7,000 talents of refined silver, to overlay the walls of the house with that. Gold for the things of gold, silver for the things of silver, and for all manner of work to be made by the hands of the artificers. Who then is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? After he made the preparation, then he called on all the other people and he said, "Are you ready?" And they said they were ready. If you read the whole chapter, you'll see what he did. That's what we are going to do. I said that's what we are going to do. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 6. Proverbs chapter 6. We're looking at it from verse 6. Proverbs chapter 6. Preparation. There's personal preparation. There is, plural preparation to all the various sections. Being prepared for the coming, for this coming retreat. In Proverbs chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 6 here. It says in verse 6, "Go to the ant, thou sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise." In verse 7, "Which having no guide, overseer or ruler, provideth her meat in the summer and gathereth her food in the harvest." It says, now we're talking about food preparation. We need to understand that if we're expecting 1,000 people, so of course in the regions, you're expecting 1,000 people, then how much food will they need? Which ones are the perishables that you cannot buy now? You'll buy maybe a day or two to the retreat. Which ones are preserved that you can buy at this time now? Which one can you buy in bulk? All that will prepare. It says we should go to the ants and learn, because they prepare their meat ahead of time. That it is not when that day comes, you'll be on it, elder and skelter. Or maybe you have 5,000 there at the retreat and then you prepared for only 1,000. Or maybe you have 20,000, you prepare only 15,000. It says we should be well prepared, like those ants are prepared. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 30. I'm reading from verse 25. Proverbs chapter 30. We're looking at verse 25. It says, the ants are people not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. They prepare their meat before the time arrives, before winter arrives, before the cold arrives. They prepare their meat in the summer. In fact, I've been looking at those ants, and I'm sure that you have looked at those ants. You have wondered. It says there are people that are not strong, and yet see what they do. And as I look at them, I want to show you some qualities of the ants that the Lord is saying, get these qualities in your preparation. Everything that you're doing, make sure that you are like these ants. And I'm using those letters for the name ants, A-N-T-S. A, activity with initiative. Activity with initiative. You've never seen any ant just staying idle, not doing anything. There's activity. They're always active. They're taking this. Although their sizes are very small, they unite together and they're very, very active, and they take initiative. Nobody has to say, put this one here, put this one there. Activity with initiative. And networking with interest. Networking. You'll not see them just walking together. If somebody is carrying, so one of those ants carrying something, another one comes, and by the time you turn aside to see, they're networking already. And they do it with interest, they do it with joy, excitement. It's not that somebody is pushing them, why don't you join them? Why don't you take part in? Not the ants. The ants, they network with interest. Their heart is there, their mind is there, their interest is there. That's what the Lord is telling us. Say, go and learn from the ants. As we are preparing for this retreat, there will be activity with initiative. There will be networking with interest. There will be tenacity. The T, there's tenacity in industry. Tenacity in industry. They never give up. We're not going to give up. I say, we're not going to give up. The technicians are just there all the time. The thing looks big, but they keep on pushing, they keep on drawing, they keep on dragging until the thing is taken out of the way. If you put, let's say you put a hurdle before them, or maybe a rod before them, they will circumvent and go the other way, because they're not going to give up. That's what I was saying. As we're preparing for this retreat, we have a challenge that we'll just go through that and just go away. Another difficulty, I'll just go around and go away, because we're going to get this work done. And we're going to do it like the ants. We're going to be tenacious in industry. S is selflessness with insight. Selflessness with insight. They're selfless. They're selfless. When they get all that food, they do not say, well, this one, you will not eat out of this. They all share together. There's selflessness among them, which means that this section is helping that section to succeed. This section is helping that other section to succeed, because they have insight as to how we can carry this thing from this place and carry it to that place. And yet there's selflessness there. That's what the Lord is saying. The Lord is saying, go to the ants and learn activity. Go to the ants and learn networking. Go to the ants and learn tenacity. And go to the ants and learn selflessness. We're going to do that in Jesus' name. We'll continue with our preparation. We've seen that we need to prepare for the food, for the meals we're going to eat. Are we going to eat three meals? How do we prepare? Are we going to eat two meals? How do we prepare? Who are going to be the cooks, so that you cook this way, you cook that way, you serve this way, serve this way, serve. We don't waste any time at all. Everything is up to time. And it's in our preparation that is done. We're looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 35. 2 Chronicles chapter 35. I'm reading from verse 15 there. 2 Chronicles chapter 35. And we're looking at verse 15. In 2 Chronicles chapter 35, look at verse 15. It says, and the singers, the sons of Asaph, were in their place. according to the commandments of David and of Asaph and Haman and Jeduthun, the king's seers and the porters waited at every gate. And it says that they might depart from them, they might not depart from their service, for their brethren, the Levites, prepared for them, prepared for them, prepared for them. That's our preparation. You see, in that verse, it mentioned the singers on the one hand and the ushers on the other hand. And it says that the singers must prepare. That is, they look at the messages and they look at the appropriate songs. And then the leaders will prepare for them. Where will they stay? Where will they put their musical instruments? And where will they have electricity and all those things? We'll prepare for them, of course. They too, they're preparing. It says the singers, the sons of Asaph, and then with all these other leaders prepared. And then it says, and also in the middle of that verse, the porters waited at every gate. Those are the ushers. They waited at every gate and then at the conclusions. That's because their people, the Levites, prepared for them. That's the preparation we're making. When that preparation is done, it's going to be marvelous. I said it's going to be marvelous. What's the result of that when the preparation is there for the singers, for the ushers, for the security? We're looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, I'm reading there from verse 20. It says, and they rose early in the morning and went forth in the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, and so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, and so shall ye prosper. Are you ready to prosper? You will in Jesus' name. Look at verse 21. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord. He appointed singers unto the Lord. You see, they knew that this battle was not, to shoot arrows and all that. If we just praise the Lord, if our singers are well prepared, and if our leaders prepare them, and they make the place they're going to stay comfortable for them, and they're really happy that with every preparation, and then they do everything, they deal with their heart, and the singers are singing, and the preachers are preaching, and the prayer warriors are praying, and all the people are joining hands together, networking together, this is going to be the best retreat you ever attended in your life. Because it's going to be great and wonderful in Jesus' name. It says that they should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 22, and when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushment against the children of Ammon, Moab, and the Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. And it says, and the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to slay and to destroy, and to destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped to destroy another. And when Judah came toward the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked unto the multitude, and behold, there were dead bodies falling to the earth, and none escaped. Your enemies will not escape. All those afflictions will not escape. God will deal with every one of them in Jesus' name. You know why? Because of preparation. Because of preparation. I'm looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 35 from verse 3. 2 Chronicles chapter 35. We're looking at it from verse 3. It says, and said unto the Levites that taught all Israel. Yeah, we come now to those who are going to teach, those who are going to teach the Bible studies, or those who are going to be workers in one area or the other. They are teaching children, or you are teaching the youth, or you are teaching any section. We come to the preparation that we have to make. And said unto the Levites that taught all Israel, which were holy unto the Lord. You'll be holy unto the Lord. Put the holy ark in the house which Solomon the son of David king of Israel did build. It shall not be a burden upon your shoulders. Serve now the Lord your God and his people Israel, and prepare yourselves. Workers, prepare yourself. We are prepared in Jesus' name. You see all the preparation the Lord is talking about. Prepare yourselves by the houses of your fathers after your courses. Then it says, according to the writing of David, king of Israel, and according to the writing of Solomon his son, and stand in the holy place according to the divisions of the families of the fathers of your brethren, the people, and after the division of the families of the Levites. What the Lord is telling us is that the preparation is going to be universal. Everybody preparing. Look at verse 6. It says, so kill the Passover, sanctify yourselves, prepare your brethren, that they may do according to the word of the Lord by the mouth of Moses. Prepared, 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 we're prepared in Jesus' name. We're looking at Ezekiel chapter 38, verse 7. Ezekiel chapter 38. And we're looking at verse 7 there. Ezekiel chapter 38. And I'm reading from verse 7. Preparation. The preparation of all the people, all the workers, all the leaders, all the singers, all the scourge, and all the ushers, everyone, the children, church leaders, and the youth leaders, everyone prepared. We're prepared in Jesus' name. Let's look at Ezekiel chapter 37, chapter 38, rather. We're looking at verse 7. Verse 7. Be thou prepared and prepare for thyself, thou and all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. Guard, that means security. That means the preparation is just everywhere, everyone. The security children to be well prepared. If you have enough security in your region, in your location, you get them prepared. If you don't have enough, you can apply to the police and to the army in that community, and they'll be wonderfully ready to help. They've been helping, and as they help, the Lord will bless them in Jesus' name. So then we go to point number 2 now. After the preparation is the publicity, the proclamation. We're talking about proclamation by people desiring the promised blessing. Proclamation by people desiring the promised blessings. The Lord is telling us that we need to prepare, and we need to make everyone hear. Isaiah chapter 34. Isaiah chapter 34. We're reading from verse 1. A kind of publicity this time is not just a local scene, a private scene that only people in one street corner there will hear. Everyone this time, they will know something is going to happen. I said they will know something is going to happen, because they're going to blast it and we're going to blaze it abroad until everybody hears in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 34 verse 1. Come near, ye nations, to hear and hearken, ye people. Let the earth hear, that is, sound it aloud, sound it, spread it abroad. Let everyone hear, let the earth hear, and all that is therein, and the world, and all things that come forth of it. It says this one is not a local thing that we just hide ourselves and just whisper to each other. It says we're going to bless this one abroad until everyone will hear. Everyone in our world, everyone in our community, they will hear. We're looking at Psalm 68, verse 11. Psalm 68, verse 11. How will everybody hear? Well, by everybody taking part in it. All the people of the congregation, all the children of God taking part in this and blessing it abroad. In Psalm 68, verse 11, the Lord gave the word, and great was the company of those that published it. That word "publisher" is the same as publicize. Let me read with that word "publicize." Now it says, "The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those that did what? Publicized it." He has given it already. He tells us that during this retreat, it's going to mightily bless us. It's going to make us celebrate the miracle of Calvary, the miracle that comes from Calvary. And he says he wants everybody to publicize that and tell everyone around that this is what the Lord wants to do. Let's look at Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. And see how it happened, how other people said it, how other people did it, how you are going to do it, how we are going to do it together. In Mark chapter 1 verse 45, Mark chapter 1 verse 45, but he went out and began to publish it much. Again, let me use that word publicize, because they mean the same thing. It says, and he went forth and began to, tell me out loud, publicized it much, and to blaze abroad the matter, in so much that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places, and they came to him, tell me, from every quarter. No local government was left out, and no province was left out, and there's no division that was left out, there's no area community was left out. They all came from every quarter, and that's what we are going to do. Where we came from, all the people there, all the streets there, all the communities there, all the local governments there, they will hear it in Jesus' name. Because it says, as he went single-handedly, think about that, he went on and around, and then it says people heard about that, and he came from every quarter. Let me show you another person. It says in verse chapter 5 of Mark chapter 5, and I'm reading there from verse 19. Mark chapter 5 verse 19, how be Jesus suffered him not, but says unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord has done for thee and has had compassion on thee. This man, you know, had real demonic problem, a legion, that means thousands of demons living inside him, and Jesus delivered him. He wanted to just stay like that. Jesus said, no, no, go to your friends, go to your household, and go tell them what the Lord has done for you, how he has had compassion on you. Verse 20, and he departed and began to publish, give me the word, publicize in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel. And that's what the Lord wants us to do. If you are saved, talk about that salvation. If you have been redeemed, talk about that redemption. If you have been healed, talk about that healing. If you are delivered, talk about that deliverance. If you have been prospered, talk about that prosperity. If you have been sanctified, talk about that sanctification. If you have been blessed in every, talk about that blessing, and let the people marvel. How could God, I was like this, see what I am today. I was down there, I'm up here now. I was so sick and sickly and evilly. Look at me, I'm so strong and healthy. Now talk about it and bless it abroad and publicize it everywhere, so that everybody will say, if you have got that, and I got that at the other retreat, we went the other time, and the Lord touched me and turned my life around, and things are different and no longer the same. Talk about that, so that other people too, they'll be eager, they'll want to be there, they will come with you. I'm going to follow up that man. This man I read about in Mark. Let me read about him in Luke, and you will see what really happened. Luke chapter 8 from verse 38. Luke chapter 8, verse 38. It says, now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, return to thine own house and show how great things God has done unto thee. And he went his way and publicized throughout the whole city. You see that? He took it as full-time job. He said, this time everybody will know. I was demon possessed, I was demonized, I was mad, I was insane, I didn't have any sense at all. And then the mighty power of God came upon me, and I'm totally delivered. I'm going to tell them, everybody will hear. He wasn't ashamed. You know, some people, they're ashamed. They're ashamed. They say, if they hear that you are mad before, they'll be looking at you. One guy said, no, that's what I was. I was mad, I was insane, but now I'm all right. You'll be all right in Jesus' name. And then you'll tell everybody around that this is what I am, this is who I am. I am, and this is what the Lord has done for me. And then he says, look at it, he says, throughout the whole city, how great things Jesus has done unto him. Look at verse 40. And it came to pass that when Jesus returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. As a result of what that man did, everybody was waiting. You'll bring people to the Lord. I said, you'll bring people to the Lord. And then this time we're going to use all methods applicable. So we're going to, you know, use the church bus and commercial buses. What a wonderful thing, all of us. And, you know, you in your district there, you all park into that bus, and then you drive to a particular place, and then you all come down. People are wondering, who are these and what's happening there? And then we scatter here, there, and there, all the handbills in our hands. And then we begin to distribute with the joy of the Lord, with a smile on our faces, not somebody gloomy. And he said, can you have this one? we're going to have a retreat, no smile on his face. How will they accept that all? But joy. I said joy. Joy, joy, joy. We'll distribute with joy in Jesus' name. And then when you know, and they look at the, you know, you write a Deeper Life Bible Church on that bus and everybody, and everybody will go direction of the retreat location in Jesus' name. And that's what this man did, that throughout the city he publicized it. And when Jesus came, everybody was now waiting. And let's look at Esther chapter 8. Esther chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 13 and verse 14. Esther chapter 8, and we're looking at verse 13 as well as verse 14. And see what he did. And this is what we're going to do. I said, this is what we're going to do. Chapter 8 of Esther, we're looking at verse 13. It says, the copy of the writing for a commandment to be given to in every province was publicized unto all the people, that the Jews should be ready against that day to avenge themselves of their enemies. So the posts that rode upon mules and camels went out, being hastened and pressed on by the king's commandment. And the decree was given at Shushan the palace. What happened here is that they said that the Jews will defend themselves, and so they wrote that in the decree, just like we write all the that God will do, or some of the things God will do on the handbills. And then we take that by post, we take that by bus. Commercial buses are there. You get in there and you announce, you publicize, you proclaim that retreat, and then you give the handbills in that retreat. You follow the routes of all those buses. It's going from this place to this place. You enter, and our brother, sister is entering that one, and our brothers are entering that one. If there are trains, so enter the train. Anywhere, anything, any kind of motion, anything that is moving, you use all those things, and then you, everybody will hear. Those who are doing on ground, they are doing it on ground. Those who are doing the bus, they are doing the bus. Those who are doing through the train, they are doing through the train. Everywhere, we are telling everybody. On the radio, they are hearing. Television, they are hearing. Everywhere, they are hearing. By the time we get there, even before we get there, miracles will be happening. The expectation of the people bring realization. And when they expect that God is going to bless them, God will bless them. And of course, you will bring them the blessings God will shower upon them. It will multiply in your life in Jesus' name. I come now to point number three, participation and prayer for the promised blessing. Participation and prayer for the promised blessing. You see, it's a participation. If you know that God is going to rain blessings down, He's going to solve all problems, He's going to roll mountains away, He's going to heal your sickness, He's going to destroy the works of the devil, that's the place you'll be at that time. You'll not say, well, I want to go to the village at this time. Village will wait. This time is for retreat time. I said it's retreat time. Somebody is, you know, texting you and phoning you. Well, this is holiday period. I want to come and visit you. Say, come and visit the Lord. We're going to say, come on and go with me. You're not going to stay back at home saying, I'm going to receive visitors or whatever. You want to receive the heavenly intervention. And that heavenly intervention will not fail your life in Jesus' name. Deuteronomy chapter 31. Deuteronomy 31. I'm reading now from verse 11. It says, when all Israel is come to appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose. In the place which he shall choose. There's a place the Lord is making choice of. And he's saying, that's your retreat location. The Lord has chosen that place. That's your retreat location. The Lord has chosen that place. In the place which the Lord shall choose, thou shalt read this law before all Israel in their hearing. Gather the people together. Gather the people together. Gather them together. The men and the women and the children. And thy stranger that is within thy gaze, that they may hear and that they may learn and fear the Lord your God and observe to do all the words of this law, and that their children which have not known anything may hear and learn to fear the Lord your God as long as she live in the land which she go over Jordan to possess it. You see the commandment of the Lord, that's what he wants us to do. And let's look at 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 21. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? The Lord is saying, you are hearing all this, that something great is coming, something wonderful is coming, marvelous is coming. How long are you going to stay between two opinions? Should I go? Shouldn't I go? Of course you ought to go. Should I obey? Shouldn't I obey? Of course you ought to obey. Will I be with the people of God? Or will I go and do another? Of course you ought to be with the people of God. How long will you be with between two opinions? If the Lord be God, come serve him. And if you know God is going to do wonderful things, great things, then come. And the Lord will bless you in Jesus' name. Look at it from verse 30 now. We're reading from verse 30. It says, and Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord. And he made a trench about the altar, as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order, and cut the bullock in pieces, and laid him on the wood, and said, fill 4 barrels with water, and put it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And he said, do it the second time. And he did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time. And he did it the third time. And the water ran round about the altar. And he filled a trench also with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. This preparation is at the word of the Lord. And when we do everything, preparation, publicity, proclamation, prayer, according to the word of the Lord, something is going to happen. It will happen in your life. It will happen in your family. It will happen to the whole church in Jesus' name. Hear me, O Lord, in verse 37, hear me, that the people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell. Everybody say, the fire of the Lord fell. Say that again. Say that one more time. The fire of the Lord will fall in Jesus' name. It will burn every chaff in your life. Every kind of contrary spirit will drive them away in your life. Every sickness will burn it off. All the defeat and all the sorrow will burn them off in Jesus' name. And consume the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stone and the doors, and lick up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, you will see it. You are going to see something when you come to this retreat. You'll see blind eyes open. You'll see the lame rising up and walking. You'll see the deaf hearing. And you'll see many miracles God is going to perform in Jesus' name. You're going to see lives transformed. You're going to see believers strengthened, energized, and revived. And you're going to see the mighty outpouring of the Spirit of God upon sanctified believers in Jesus' name. When the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. That will be your testimony this time in Jesus' name. It is going to happen. I said it is going to happen. That's what the Lord is telling us, to prepare our hearts and get ready, because there's going to be publicity, participation, as well as prayer. And when we pray in that place, the prayer of that place is going to be very different. That's what the Lord is calling us now to, real intercession. And he said, prepare for that time. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. I'm reading there from verse, I'm reading from verse 12. Joel chapter 2, and we're looking at it from verse 12. It says, therefore also now says the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your heart, and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, and slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. It says we should turn to him, we should pray, we should repent. If there's anything we need to kind of get rid of that God is not happy with in our lives, in our families, families in the church, we get rid of them. Look at verse 15. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breast, and let the bridegroom go forth of their chamber, of his chamber, and the bride out of her closet, and let the priest and the ministers of the Lord weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thine heritage to reproach, that the heathen shall say, shall rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? Look at what they are saying today. You know, somebody is sick there for a long time, they say, where is your God? Somebody is not having job a long time, where is your God? You are old enough to marry, there's no marriage, where is your God? And then you mind, there's no child, where is your God? All the things they're saying, we're going to reverse everything. Yeah. All those questions, you say this, you can pray, you say you can fast, you say you go to deeper life, you say this, you say that, but where is this? They will see it. I said they will see it. In fact, they're going to come to confess to you that they have been thinking that your God was not powerful, was not mighty, but wait for this thing. When we get to that place, by the grace of God, the heavens will open. And the power of the Lord manifested mightily in Jesus' name. Look at verse 18. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. It says, yea, the Lord will answer. I said the Lord will answer. And say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and you shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. Look at this, verse 20. And I will remove far off from you the northern army, and will drive him into a land barren and desolate. It says, with his face toward the east, the east sea. And it says, and his hinder path toward the uttermost sea. And then it goes on to say, his stink shall come up, and his ill savor shall come up, because he has done great things. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. For the Lord will do great things. For the Lord will do great things. The time has arrived. I said the time has arrived. Are you ready? I said, are you ready? Ready and sitting down. Are you ready? Are you ready? Why don't you tell the Lord, oh Lord, I want to see. Oh Lord, I want to taste. Oh Lord, I want to be part of that. I'm going to be part of that. Your family will be part of that. Your children will be part of that. Husband, wives will be part of that. All the whole church, I invite you. We're going to be part of this. The Lord is saying, he is ready now, and he wants to pour out his abundance upon his people. He wants to show us mercy. He wants to show us compassion. He wants to heal our sicknesses. He wants to deliver us. He wants to save all those who have been long standing there, and yet they have not been born again. He wants to empower us. He wants to do great, 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 mighty things in our midst. Why don't you tell the Lord right now, Lord, I'll be part of that. Lord, I'll be part of that. Lord, I'll be part of that. The Lord is calling upon you, that you will understand that during this time, there's going to be a great and a mighty outpouring. A great and a mighty outpouring. We're talking about these coming retreats. You must be part of those who are going to celebrate. The power of God will come upon your life like never before. And the healing of the Lord will take place in your body like never before. And deliverance in your brain, your mind, your nerves, every part of you, you'll experience that deliverance like never before. Something great is coming. Something wonderful is coming. And you're going to be part of that. Tell the Lord, tell the Lord, I'm going to be part of this, I'm going to be part of this. Personal preparation. Personal preparation. Proper preparation. A positive, practical preparation that's going to make. If there's anything that will hinder you from getting the best of God, you are telling the Lord now, oh Lord, take that away, take that away. I want to see the goodness of God. I want to see the glory of God. I want to see the abundance of the Lord. I want to see the outpouring of the power of the Lord upon my life. Prepare yourself, prepare yourself. Let our leaders prepare. Prepare the ground. Prepare the habitation. Children's section, prepare that. Prepare the youth section. Prepare the women's section. Prepare the adult section, the men's section. Prepare the auditorium. Prepare the choir. And prepare the place they're going to stay. Prepare. Prepare. And prepare for my God a habitation. Prepare for the food. Prepare for all the materials that we need for every section. Let nothing be left undone. Be thorough about it. Vigilant about it. What do you need to buy? What do you need to purchase? Physical preparation, spiritual preparation, prayerful preparation. Let's do that. Let's do that. Remember the ants? Active with initiative. Take initiative. Look at what ought to be done. Look at what we need to provide. Be active, be active, be active, not idle. Activity with initiative. Networking with interest. Help others. Encourage others. Excite others. Network with interest. Be an encouragement to other sections. And of course, your section too. Tenacity in industry. Be tenacious about that. Be tenacious about that. Be thorough. Be tenacious. Top-minded. Don't give up. Selflessness with insight. Learn from those ants. Learn from those ants. And let's wait upon the Lord. Real praying. Abiding heaven. Sending a request to heaven. Expectation brings realization. Faith is going to be a fruit. Tell the Lord. And then from now till that time, let's organize ourselves in effectual fervent prayer of the righteous, that availeth much. And pray for all sections. All sections. So that God will give us the very best during this retreat. And make it the best we've ever seen. The greatest, the highest, the most spiritual, having the greatest of impacts that we've ever seen. Get ready yourself. Let's be doers of the word and not hearers only. If you do it and I do it and we all do it together, great, wonderful. Will be the result of this coming retreat. Tell the Lord, also pour that abundance upon your life. Salvation, healing, deliverance, righteousness, holiness, sanctification, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost in a mighty baptism. Mountains to be removed, all hills to be leveled, and the valleys to be filled. Impossibilities to become possible. The Lord is ready, and the Lord is calling upon you. Be an active part of the glorious scene the Lord wants to do. Clear all hindrances out of the way. You'll be there. Your family will be there. Your friends will be there. Let's all be there. Intensify the publicity. Publicize it. Tell it everywhere. Let the whole community, let them hear. Let the whole province hear. Let the whole local government hear. Let everyone in your city hear about this. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors. Leave no stone unturned. Do everything that needs to be done. Everyone must hear and lead them to a decision to be there. And organize, arrange that you will be with them, you will go with them. Great blessings await us at the retreat.